Jim Hamm likes to say, you never know what a man's life is like until you've walked in his shoes. Jim has walked many a mile in the shoes of his ancestors, rough and ready pioneers whose goal was simple survival. But he says even their lives couldn't match the hardships and accomplishments of the original Americans. It's those people Jim really wants to understand.
Pretty hard for the most part. Pretty difficult. So those guys were really, really rugged to be able to live like they did. When you try to recreate what they were doing, you can't help but appreciate them and admire them. Looking at the museum pieces and then actually taking the wood and trying to recreate what they were doing, it's so deceptively simple. People look and say, that bow is just a piece of wood, it's just a stick. But when you spend 50 hours trying to make it and break 10 in a row, you start to finally appreciate what they were able to do. They were pretty artistic and pretty talented to do what they did.
For 15 years, Jim Hamm has made bows and arrows just like the ones used by early American Indians. He makes them simple, and he makes them out of wood. In Mason, Texas, down an alley in an old garage, Laura Hunt and Spider Johnson are practicing what's called marquetry, an art form almost too complicated to describe unless you lived 400 years ago.
Marquetry is fairly obscure in this country. It has a considerable heritage in continental Europe, and especially in Italy, where it reached its ascendancy during the Italian Renaissance in the 16th and 17th centuries. I would say marquetry is the process of rendering a pictorial design or representation using different pieces of wood cut out and pieced together like a jigsaw puzzle. People always think it's a painting. So when we tell them what it is, they always take a closer look.
Without a drop of paint, Spider and Laura have created startling representations. It's been said that Ron's stories of breaking and trading horses and chasing cattle and whatnot calls for a good steady reading chair and a tall glass of iced tea. Stories like Ned the Cavalry Horse, Cowtown Buckskin Bronc, Hat Trick Mare. Stories about life, Ron Westmoreland's life.
Well, it's really, it's about Western things. Not exactly Westerns, but set in a Western setting.
People come in from time to time for the first time that meet us, you know. I was back when he was quite a bit younger and say, you're not old enough to know a lot about a violin. And I'd been to lunch one day and came in and this man, Lloyd, introduced me. He said, well, if you know what that, know anything about a violin, you'll know what that is. And he held a violin up to me like that. It'll put me on the spot. I said, that's a very fine Amati, sir. And he looked pleasant at me, you know, and we got some jobs from him.
In this little shop on the north side of Fort Worth, Lloyd and Bill Tennyson have repaired some of the finest violins in the world, from a 17th century Stradivarius to this 350-year-old Guarnieri. In 44 years, Lloyd and Bill Tennyson have become surgeons of strings.
A man creates a violin, he doesn't make it. And all the measurements are right, the graduations inside are proper, the bass bar is put in it proper. And then one can take that violin and actually protrude your soul through it, I think. It's one of the instruments that you can come closer of really getting the inside out from a man as I've ever known of, the violin.
They are the sons and grandsons of carpenters. Bill was 16, Lloyd 13, when they built their first house.
If I cleaned off my desk, I'd be totally lost. I can't hardly find the blame stuff now, and if I file it somewhere, I sure couldn't find it.
One item on Wendy's desk illustrates his popularity in West Texas, an envelope which arrived in the Beckham mailbox from another town. No zip code, no address, no name. Just a picture of Wendy on a blank envelope.
Oh, my. I use a typewriter all the time. If I've got anything to write, I just get in there and hunt and peck it. Hunt the key and peck on it. I got two or three calls from Lubbock recently. When the paper came out, they called me. They sure enjoyed the story.
Wendy Beckham's fame reaches much farther than Lubbock.
Said his for what it's worth department likes to read W.J. Beckham, known affectionately around La Mesa, Texas as Wendy Beckham. Wendy and his wife Joe telephoned the TV repairman to come back for a second time, insisting that something was still wrong with their television set. It was all fuzzy and blurry. It was then that the Beckhams discovered they had mistakenly picked up and were wearing one another's eyeglasses. Paul Harvey, good day.
Wendy shares page 2 of the La Mesa newspaper with Paul Harvey, and Paul Harvey shares Wendy Beckham with the world. For as long as these old keys can rattle and clink like an ancient machine, the world's lowest paid newspaper columnist will feed his readers priceless humor by W.J. Wendy Beckham.
I just write these jokes, and there's not much to them, you know. Have to love you. I-N-D, that is. People think I can't write, won't they? Yeah.